Dear students, here we are going to talk about understanding of displacement current. This is a new name you have heard first time, displacement current, because the current we were talking of till now was actually the conduction current, which was due to the flow of free electrons in a conductor. Here this is very important concept to understand the basis of electromagnetic waves. That's why we first need to talk about displacement current and then we'll proceed further. And to understand displacement current, we just need to recall about Ampere's law that we already discussed in previous chapter, which says that line integral of magnetic induction in a region along a closed path is equal to the product of mu naught and the current passing through the loop. Here, how we apply Ampere's law, that's very important to understand if we just have a recap of how Ampere's law is applied. If we talk for a straight wire, which is carrying a current I. Here, if at point P we wish to find the magnetic induction due to the wire, you have studied if this point P is located at a distance r, we consider a circular loop, which is a closed loop, we name it M. And we consider the area of this loop through which the current I is passing. Here you need to understand very carefully this area, we say we name it as S. So in this situation we can write by Ampere's law, we use integration for B dot dl for the closed path M is equals to mu naught I. Here you need to be very careful that what is I? I is the current intercepted by the surface S. This is the area surface which we are showing by etching or shading. So this is intercepted by the surface S, which spans the path M. The surface S is at its periphery connected with the path M. So the current which is intercepted by the surface which is spanning the path M is the current I, and the current passing through it is I, and that is used in this Ampere's law. Here for this elemental section of length dl, we can see by right hand thumb rule magnetic induction would be tangential like this, and by symmetry, as B is uniform, we can write it B multiplied by integration of dl for the whole path length is 2 pi r, that is mu naught I, and this giving us a value of B is equals to mu naught I by 2 pi r. This is the way how we calculate the magnetic induction in surrounding of a wire. We can also change the application if the same situation is given to us like this, where again in the straight wire I current is flowing, and again at point P we consider a loop which is of radius r, and the loop path is M, and for this path M, if we wish to apply the Ampere's law, we need to find out the current intercepting the surface S which is spanning the path M. So in this situation the surface S can take up any shape. This is very important. We can write surface S can take up any shape. That's very important, you need to understand. Here, if I consider a surface like this, this is the shape of a container of which the mouth is open and representing this path M. And this is the surface. Again, at its mouth, it spans the path M. And here we consider this as surface S. In this situation also, you can see for the path M, we can see it is bisymmetry with the current carrying wire. At every point, magnetic induction would be tangential and uniform, as it does not affect on surface S, because both M and S we are considering as imaginary path and imaginary surfaces. You might be wondering why I'm taking such a shape, because the concept which we have studied till now on Ampere's law and the application of Ampere's law, such a case you haven't encountered, but now you need to understand how in a different ways Ampere's law can be applied, because again in this situation through surface S, same current I is intercepting. So again we can apply integration of B dot dl for the path length M. This mu naught multiplied by the current which is intercepting the surface S is I again. So the relation remains same, and for the path length M, you can again write B multiplied by 2 pi r, that's integration of dl is mu naught I, and we are getting B is equals to mu naught I by 2 pi r. So in the same way, we are getting the result. So you can very well understand by changing the shape of surface which spans the path M on which we are applying the Ampere's law does not affect the result. So the value of magnetic induction must remain same no matter what type of surface S shape is taken. You can also have a complete recap of Ampere's law in previous chapters where you have studied, and using Ampere's law we have calculated the magnetic induction due to a current carrying sheet, due to a solenoid, any other cases where you applied Ampere's law. You can change the shape of surface and you can find the result remains same. In continuation, let us now understand using Ampere's law in surrounding of a charging capacitor. Here, if we consider a case, so when we are given with a capacitor and the wires are carrying a current I, so you know well if for this capacitor current I is coming on the left plate, the positive charge Q would be increasing because current would be depositing the charge, and on the right surface, right plate surface, minus Q is increasing as current is extracting the charge. And here we can write I is equals to dq by dt, the rate at which the charge on the capacitor plate is changing. Now in the situation, say if we wish to find out magnetic induction at this point P at a distance r from the wire. By symmetry here we can see for application of Ampere's law we consider a loop path M. And here along the plane of this loop we consider the surface S through which current I is getting intercepted. Then we can write by using Ampere's law, we have in this situation we can write for path M it is integration of B dot dl. And we apply the same on path M, it gives us mu naught, and the current intercepted by the surface S is I. By symmetry, we can see magnetic field induction would be along the tangent to the surface, and it remain uniform because of symmetry. So we can again write B multiplied by 2 pi r is equals to mu naught I. Or that is giving us the magnetic induction at point P, which is mu naught I by 2 pi r. If we consider the same situation by changing the shape of the surface, here you can see again we have the same capacitor plate. The current here is I. On the positive plate, the positive charge is growing, increasing. negative charge is also increasing here, and current is dq by dt. And again, we wish to find out the magnetic induction at point P by use of Ampere's law, and we consider a circular surface, circular path M of radius R. But now, instead of taking the surface spanning the path M, not in the plane of this loop M or path M, we consider it like a ball like this. This is again in shape of a container, of which the bottom is passing in the region between the capacitor plates. So this is a container surface we are considering. This is the surface S. Now if you carefully have a look, then we can see by using Ampere's law, we can write, by Ampere's law we have integration for the path M, because we know Ampere's law, line integral we calculate for the path M B dot dl, which remains same here. But on the right hand side, the current which is intercepting through the surface S is zero, as no current is intercepting the surface S. So here we are getting B multiplied by 2 pi r is equals to zero. So this is giving us the magnetic induction at point 2B zero. And here you can see there is an inconsistency, as the results must be same no matter what type of surface S we choose. So here we can see as the Ampere's law does not depend, or we can write Ampere's law application does not depend upon the shape of surface S. If this is a result 1, this is a result 2, then we can see results 1 and 2 are not consistent. That means we are missing something here in application of Ampere's law. This is very important statement you need to understand. No matter which surface S we consider, the result must remain same at point P, no matter what type of surface S we are choosing. But here in the two methods, we can see in method 1, the surface S, a current I is intercepting, but in second case through the surface S, no current is intercepting. As we can see, there is no current flowing directly from plate 1 to plate 2 of this capacitor. So in this situation, there must be something we are missing, and we can carefully see in between the capacitor plates, there is an electric field which is in existence E. So instead of current, you can see the electric field between the plate is intercepting the surface at, not directly the current. So this electric field which is intercepting the surface, here this E is also changing as charge is increasing. So this time varying electric field which is intercepting the surface S must be accounted here to make the two results consistent. So to keep the consistency between the two results, we must account this electric field which is intercepting the surface S. Now let's continue on the next sheet. Here we can see the electric field which is intercepting the surface. We can numerically calculate the electric field between capacitor plates is this E. We know it is given as Q by A epsilon naught. The sigma by epsilon naught we already studied. So due to this electric field, there is an electric flux passing through the surface. If we consider plate area to be equals to A, then electric flux intercepting the surface S is this phi electric. We can write EA as between the two plates of capacitor field is uniform. So in this situation it is Q by A epsilon naught multiplied by A, that gives us Q by epsilon naught. If this is the electric flux which is intercepting the surface S, we can differentiate it. Here we have d phi E by dt. If we differentiate this relation, this gives us 1 by epsilon naught times dq by dt. And dq by dt, we know it is current, so this is 1 by epsilon naught times I. So here you can see the current corresponding to the rate of change of flux through the surface is I can be given as epsilon naught times d phi E by dt. Here you can see this is an equivalent current intercepting the surface S, which is due to the change, here we can write, which is due to the change in electric flux d phi E by dt, the rate of change of electric flux d phi by dt. So whenever through a surface, if electric flux is changing in a time varying electric field, then we can always state it is equivalent to a current given by epsilon naught times d phi E by dt. And this current d phi E by dt is given a separate name called displacement current, because there is not an actual current conduction because of flow of free electrons. It is due to the change in the electric field vector, or sometimes it is called as electric displacement vector, an old terminology which is used. So that's why this is called as displacement current. So if this is accounted in Ampere's law, then Ampere's law becomes consistent even in the region where the electric field is time varying. So always remember about displacement current. Here we can say displacement current through a surface exists whenever there is a time varying electric flux intercepted through the surface, and this current magnitude is given as this is also sometimes referred as ID displacement current, which is epsilon naught times d phi E by dt. This is what is called displacement current. From any surface, you can say if there is a surface S, there is no current flowing, but there exists an electric field through the surface which is given as a function of time. That means through the surface the flux will start changing. So we can directly state here displacement current So S is this given as ID, and is written as epsilon naught times d phi by dt. So phi is E multiplied by S, as we are taking the electric field normal to the surface. So this will be F prime T times S. This is very important for you to understand, where F prime T is dE by dt times S, and the unit used for it is remaining the same. Unit is ampere, or we denote it by symbol A, because it is a current which is corresponding to the rate of change of electric flux through a surface. Its unit remains same, which is ampere, just like that of conduction current. Here displacement current is also considered to be having the same unit amperes, and its role will also remain same. So you need to be careful if we consider this displacement current, as in the previous case we have seen here. The current is epsilon naught d phi e by dt. If you substitute it in this relation instead of 0, we consider this d phi e by dt is corresponding to a given current. So if we substitute the value of current over here, the result will become consistent.